We're glad that you're joining us via the airwaves, via Facebook. We appreciate it, and I want you to join right in and worship with us. We appreciate you all so very much as we appreciate all of you that are here, that have come, and we appreciate those that have come back and visiting with us a second and third time. You're now family, so we appreciate it. And Diane and Brian, glad that you're here. Diane's grandchildren are with her, and we're glad that you guys are here today. Dolores is back with us too, and we're glad that you guys are all here. Join in with us today and worship. Hope you have in the song service and will in the remainder of the service. All right, before the message today, Rachel's going to come and sing for us.
Of sky and sea, I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save. I who made the stars of night, I will make their dawn. If you leave.
Wow, thank you, Rachel. That was a powerful, powerful song. I'll tell you, the Lord of what I'm seeing in our church in the last few weeks is that God is beginning to move us toward reaching out to those that are lost. I appreciate Amelia's song a few weeks ago about that and her words about when was the last time someone approached you and said, do you know Jesus? And she can only remember maybe two or three times in your entire life. And we all think about that. And then today, maybe we should turn that around. The Lord's been working in other people's lives in this way. And we turn it around and say, well, Lord, here am I. Oh, send me. That beautiful song, Rachel, goes with the message perfectly as you, that's the way it works. Okay. So, yeah. She never knows when I'm preaching, and Amelia either. It always matches. That's the way the Lord works, and so praise the Lord. So that's also confirmation for me too. You know, I don't always get, you know, the letter in the mail that says, here's what you're preaching this week. You know, I have to work at it sometimes. Yeah, all the time, believe me. All right, we appreciate that so much. What a blessing. Rachel got to do double duty when she sings the fourth Sunday. Then she gets the first Sunday too, so she gets two. But I tell you what, I could take a CD of her singing. I could listen to that down the road. Just that's that calming voice. The Lord is really using her. I know she doesn't feel that way, but that's the way it comes across. And I tell you, when she first started, all of those ripplings in her voice and things have all smoothed out, and her range has gotten higher. And it's really, really a blessing, and I really, really appreciate it. All right. Good News Explorers, you are dismissed. You'll be following Amelia and Carol this morning. If you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, turn to Matthew chapter 8. Matthew chapter 8. You're going to see your song immediately, Rachel. Matthew chapter 8, we're going to look at verses 23 through 27. Matthew chapter 8, verse 23. And when he was entered into a ship, his disciples followed him, this is Jesus, and behold, there arose great tempest in the sea, insomuch that the ship was covered with the waves, but he was asleep. And his disciples came to him and awoke him, saying, Lord, save us, we perish. And he saith unto them, why are ye fearful, O ye of little faith? Then he arose and he rebuked the winds and the sea, and there was a great calm. But the men marveled, saying, what manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? This morning I want to preach on the subject, what will you do with this man Jesus? And also I want us to remember Trisha's sister in Florida who is really sick. And her name is Marty. And she wanted us to remember her. She has a lot of things going on and a long way away from Trish. And so, but not a long way away from God. Amen. And so let's pray and remember Marty as we pray. Father, we're just thankful for your word. We're thankful for your son. We're thankful for Jesus. And I pray as we look to that today that we can answer this question, what are we going to do with this man Jesus? There's something we're going to have to do even in this service today. We will make a choice to either follow him or reject him today. There's no ifs, ands, or buts about it. There's no middle ground. We just must decide. Lord, you're bringing us week after week into the valley of decisions. You're bringing us to the place where we have to stand up. You're bringing us to the place to witness. You're bringing us to the place, and I think it's because the end is near. And Lord, help us to realize that when that time comes, for many, it will be too late. I pray, Lord, that you would bless in this service. I pray that you would bless Marty. She might be in Florida, Lord, but you're right in Florida with her. And I pray that through your omnipresence and your great power, that you would touch her body, that you would meet her needs, raise her up, give her comfort and strength. You know all about Marty. And I pray that you would just minister to her today and she would know that she's been touched by you. I pray that you bless Trish. And Lord, a long way away from her sister, and I know that's hard, so give her peace and comfort and trust in you and in the power of prayer. And Lord, we'll give you the praise for all that's accomplished in this service. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. What manner of man is this that even the winds and the sea obey him? He rebuked those winds of the sea. Mark's gospel tells us he stepped to the front of the boat and he said, "Peace, be still," and a great calm fell over the sea. Can you imagine? The waves were crashing in over the bow and the water was flooding in on the boat deck and Jesus was asleep and they all thought they were going to die. They all thought they were going to perish, that there was no way. This was a great tempest and a great sea and it was raging, but nothing too great for the Lord Jesus. In Mark chapter 2, we find Jesus in Capernaum, and people have gathered. He's in a house, and people have gathered together there to see him, and he's preaching. And there were so many people that gathered that you couldn't get another person in. They were lined up around, looking through the windows, filled the house, and all around the yard and out front and everywhere. You just couldn't get in. And there were four men that had a friend who was sick, and he was paralyzed. And they wanted him to come to Jesus. They just knew that what they had heard of Jesus and who he was, that he could do something for their friend. What a friend. I hope that I have friends like that, don't you? And they took that bed, and they put him on the bed, and they took a corner, and they went and headed to where Jesus was. Well, trouble. They got there. They can't get to Jesus. They can't get through the crowd. They can't shove their way through with a man laying on a cot and they're trying to carry him through. They all want to hear what Jesus has to say. Listen, I preached a message some months ago that says, if the devil blocks the door, go through the roof. Amen? Listen, when the devil blocks our way, many times we give up, but we dare not give up. When the devil blocks our way, find another way to serve God. Find another way to get to the Lord, because it's important that we get to Jesus. It's important that we hear what he has to say. It's important we do what he wants us to do. And so whatever it takes to get to him, that's what we should do. So these guys took on a great task because they climbed up on this roof and they got up on this roof. Now, can you imagine? I want you to get the picture. Jesus is inside and he is preaching away to these people and he can see there's a great, and all of a sudden the roof starts, stuff starts falling and everybody begins to scatter and move about because they thought the roof was caving in, which it was. These guys, now listen, he's on a cot. He's not in a box and they just need a hole this size to squeeze this man down. They need room. They got him on a cot and they're covering all four corners. They had to cut a huge hole out of this roof of this home. And then they lowered him down in front of Jesus. Now, I was thinking about this and I was thinking, Jesus, you know, I'm sure he stepped back too. And then he looked up. Of course, he sees what's happening. And I can just see Jesus going, this is exactly what I'm talking about. This is exactly what I'm talking about. These guys get it. They know who I am. They brought him to the right person. And they lowered him down in front of Jesus. And he looked and said, because of their faith, your sins are forgiven. And then they all got all upset. Oh, somebody can forgive sins? Oh, that's blasphemy. Because only God can forgive sins. Well, they're exactly right. Amen. He is God. And he says, well, which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven or to rise up and walk? He says, so for your sakes, he goes, take up your bed and head home. Now, here's what the Bible says, and I like what it says, and we need to pay attention to what it says. He immediately got up on his feet, and he picked up his bed, and out the door he went, and they parted like the Red Sea, and him and his friends headed back home. I imagine they come back later and fix that roof, don't you think? But they were headed home, and immediately, I was watching a program night before last about the Apostle Paul. It was a movie about Paul. Oh man, did they butcher the scriptures. But anyways, it was a movie about Paul. And in this movie, they showed the part where Peter and John in Acts chapter 3 are on their way to the temple to pray. And there's a beggar there at the gate as they were going in, begging for alms. And he had been crippled on his feet. And he said, look on us. And that he looked as though he was going to receive something from Peter and John. And Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but what I have give I thee in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk. And the Bible says he immediately leaped to his feet. Now in the movie I was watching, they helped him up and he staggered around like this. And then the more he walked, the better he got. And then he started leaping and no. Listen, you think God needs a process? He just needs to speak it. In the name of Jesus, you're healed. He was healed as if he was just like he was when he was born as a baby. He was as healthy as could be. Everything came together at the spoken word of Christ. He immediately got on his feet and leaped up and went with them into the temple, leaping and praising God for what he had done. When Jesus had healed this man on this bed, and he got up and took his bed and went home, I want you to notice what they said about him. They were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we have never seen it on this fashion. In the book of Luke, chapter 7, we find another story. We find the story of Jesus and many of his disciples. Listen, the 12 were the ones that stayed close to Jesus, but he had a lot of disciples. He had a lot of people that followed him from place to place and around the places where he went. And he was on his way, and a lot of the disciples were following him. And he came to Nain. It was a city called Nain, N-A-I-N. And coming out of the gates of that city was a funeral. And this woman's son, her only son, had died. And she was a widow. And when Jesus saw what was going on, the Bible says he had compassion on her. He went to her and he said, fear not. Fear not. He put his hand on the coffin and they stopped. Everybody stood still. And he said, son, arise. He rose up in that coffin and began to speak and was returned to his mother. That funeral was over. Listen, folks, we need to hear the words of the Lord and understand his compassion for us. I misquoted that. See, if you were looking in your scripture, somebody should have waved me down. He didn't say, fear not. He said, weep not. Weep not. Weep not. Listen, some of the hardest things that we'll face in life is a funeral. When we face a loved one who has passed and gone on,
someone that was a good friend or someone that was a family or someone that was a spouse or a child, it's some of the worst pain that we'll face, and we'll weep over these things. And listen, there's a time for weeping, there's a time for mourning, there's a time for those things. But when Jesus showed up on the scene, he told her, no more weeping. Revelation 21 tells us that God shall wipe away all the tears from our eyes. And there'll be no more crying. And there'll be no more dying. And there'll be no more fear. Listen, the Lord will take all of those things away. One of these days, he will say to all of us, weep not anymore. And he will wipe those tears from our eyes for good. That's the Lord that we serve. Well, what do you think they had to say about Jesus when this happened? It says, and there came fear on all, and they glorified God, saying that a great prophet has risen among us, and that God has visited his people. Who is this man? What kind of man is he? Who is this man? The Bible tells us, Matthew tells us in Matthew chapter 1, that he is going to be called Jesus, and he shall save his people from their sins. He is called Emmanuel, and that word means God with us. That's exactly what they got in this funeral service. God with us. Jesus stepped in and said, weep not, and brought this young man back to life. Now the question is, what do you think of this man, Jesus? I want us to change gear just a little bit, and we're going to look at three different stories in the Word of God, and we're going to talk about each one of these. Go with me to the book of Luke, chapter 22. The book of Luke, chapter 22. Starting at verse 54. Luke 22, 54, it says, then took they him, took Jesus, and led him and brought him into the high priest's house. And Peter followed afar off. And when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the hall and were set down together, Peter sat down among them. But a certain maid beheld him as he sat by the fire and earnestly looked upon him and said, this man was also with him. And he denied him, saying, woman, I know him not. And after a little while, another saw him and said, thou art also of them. And Peter said, man, I am not. And about the space of 1 hour after, another confidently affirmed, saying, of a truth, this fellow was also with him, for he is a Galilean. And Peter said, man, I know not what thou sayest. And immediately while he yet spake, the cock crew, and the Lord turned and looked upon Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, how he had said unto him before the cock crow, thou shalt deny me thrice. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. Peter, Lord, I am ready to go with thee both into prison and to death. He said that the same night he betrayed him three times. Denied him, I should say. Peter called by God, walking away from his profession. I'm going to make you fishers of men. You are not going to fish for fish any longer. You're going to fish for men. And he walked away from that profession and followed Christ. Jesus went to Peter's house on one occasion when his mother-in-law was sick of a fever, and Jesus went to the house, laid his hands on her, and she recovered from that fever. He said on one occasion, Lord, if it's really you out on the sea, bid me come to thee on the water. And Jesus said, come. And he stepped out of that boat and began to walk on the water to Jesus. And when Jesus said on one occasion, he looked at the 12 and he said, whom do you say that I am? And Peter spoke up and said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Flesh and bone hath not revealed that to you, but my Father which is in heaven. Peter, at times, very bold in his witness. Peter, at time, getting way ahead of himself. Peter, at time, godly in his thinking and what God had revealed to him. Peter, at times, weak, and we see it in his following of the Lord afar off. And Peter, who at times stumbles in his life. I don't know about you, but doesn't that sound like us?
It sounds like me in my Christian walk, in my life. Listen, I'm sick and tired of people painting a picture of what a child of God is that is not true. To make you think that the day you get saved, you'll never have another care, you'll never have another trouble, you'll never stumble, you'll never fall, you'll never have, everything will just be beautiful and glorious all the way to glory. The Bible does not teach that. You get saved, the Spirit of God comes and indwells you, it will strengthen you. It will give you wisdom and knowledge and understanding of how to handle the trials, how to get through the tribulations, how to get over the hump, how to get around the roadblocks. We put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to withstand the wiles of the devil. When the enemy comes, what we have in us is greater than what's in this world. There are times in my life that I feel godly and I feel on top of it spiritually, but there are times that I don't, and there are times that I'm weak, and there are times that I stumble, and listen, there are times that I make mistakes in my life, and when I look at Peter and I look at his life, I find myself in him more than I want to admit. When Jesus resurrected from the dead, don't you know when he went and was crucified on the cross, after Peter had went out and wept bitterly, don't you know he just believed in his heart, he's blown it. See, when the devil gets you down, he will stomp you while you're down. He's not going to comfort you because you may have, looks like you've turned and went the other way, and you've went against the Lord when you were with the Lord, and now he's going to do you good. No, he will do you hurt. The thief cometh not before to steal and to kill and to destroy. The devil is not out for your good. Peter thought it was over. But when Jesus resurrected from the dead, he told Mary, he said, go your way and tell his disciples and Peter that I go before you into Galilee. And there you shall see him as he said unto you. What kind of man reaches down to those that have fallen and failed? What kind of man offers the forgiveness that God offers and the peace that comes, that passes all understanding? I don't even know why today, at times, that I have peace in my heart when some of the greatest disappointments come my way. I don't understand how I can have joy unspeakable and full of glory in the worst of times of my life. And yet God says, I will forgive you of your sins and I will place my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, give I to you. The world doesn't know the peace of God. The only way you can know the peace of God is to know God. When you come to know him, oh, how the peace of God will flood your soul in such a way that you'll have trouble explaining it. Do you see yourself in Peter? I do. Go with me to the book of John, chapter 20. Verse 24. John chapter 20, verse 24. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger in the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe. And after 8 days again, his disciples were within, and Thomas with them. Then came Jesus, and the doors being shut, stood in the midst and said, "Peace be unto you." Then he saith to Thomas, "Reach hither thy finger, and behold my hands, and reach hither thy hand, and thrust it into my side, and be not faithless, but believing." Thomas answered and said unto him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said, "Thomas, because thou hast seen, thou hast believed. Blessed are they that have not seen, yet have believed." Thomas says, "Oh, I know what, I hear what you're saying, guys. I hear what you're saying, but listen, I saw him nailed to the cross. I saw them thrust that spear in his side. I was there. I watched him die. I walked with him. I ate with him. I witnessed his miracles, but I saw that lifeless body wrapped and placed in Joseph's tomb. I know what you think you saw, but I need to see." Jesus said, "Doubt no more. You want to see? Come and see it. Here's the nail prints. Put your finger here. Here it is, Thomas. Put your hand in my side. Here's the spear markings. Fresh. This just happened 3 days ago or a few days ago. Remember that I said, it is to your advantage that I go away, for I will send you another comforter, the Holy Spirit, and he will abide with you forever." Listen, I have not seen Jesus, but I have received the Holy Spirit when I believed. I wasn't there when Jesus died on the cross, and I wasn't there when he rose from the dead. But I'll tell you something, I was there the day he saved my soul. You can never know what that feels like. You'll never know the peace of God. You'll never know the indwelling of the Holy Spirit, God himself in the person of the Holy Spirit living inside you until you come and see for yourself. I can tell it to you all that you want me to. I can explain it all that you want me to, and I can describe it in any way that you want me to. And listen, it's still hard for me after 40-something years. It's still hard for me to talk about it without weeping. But listen, I don't ever want to get to the place where it doesn't move my heart of what God did for me on that day in that little country church in Springfield, Tennessee, the day he saved my soul. But I'm going to tell you, you'll never really know what it's like until you experience it yourself. What kind of man takes away our doubts? Because when he placed the Holy Spirit in me, the Holy Spirit began to lead me and to guide me and to show me the truth. And I have no doubts about it. One more. Go with me to the book of Luke, chapter 23. This one might surprise you. Luke chapter 23, verse 13. Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people, verse 14, said unto them, "You have brought this man unto me as one that perverteth the people, and behold, I have examined him before you and have found no fault in this man touching those things whereof you accuse him. Nor yet did Herod, for I sent you to him, and lo, nothing worthy of death is done unto him. I will therefore chastise him and release him. For of necessity he must release one unto them at the feast of the Passover." And they cried out all at once, saying, "Away with this man and release unto us Barabbas, who for certain sedition made in the city and for murder was cast into prison." Pilate, therefore, willing to release Jesus, spake again to them. But they said, they cried, saying, crucify him, crucify him. And he said unto them the third time, why? What evil hath he done? I have found no cause of death in him. I will therefore chastise him and let him go. And they were instant with the loud voices requiring that he might be crucified. And the voices of them and of the chief priests prevailed. And Pilate gave sentence that it should be as they required. And he released unto them him that for sedition and murder was cast into prison, whom they had desired. But he delivered Jesus to their will. Barabbas, a robber, a murderer, guilty of enticing the people to rebel against authority, guilty of violent uprisings against the government. Who was Barabbas? He was nothing more than simply a sinner man. The crowd, they cried out and said, give us this murdering, robbing, rebel-leading sinner. What shall I do with Jesus? This man who had done nothing but good. He's healed your sick. He's raised your dead. He's been humiliated. He's been slapped. He's been spit on. Standing here with this crown of thorns. What should I do with this man? Crucify him. What do you think was going through the mind of Barabbas? Jesus submissively goes to the cross. Why? It's what he came for. Luke 19:10 says, the Son of Man came to seek and to save that which was lost. He came to save Barabbas. He came to die in the place of Barabbas on the cross. He came to take my place, and he came to take your place on the cross. He came to die for your sins and for my sins. Through his own blood, through his own self, he reconciled you and I back to God if you accept it. He went to the cross and he stretched out one hand and he took a hold of the Father. And he stretched out his other hand and he took a hold of man. And through his shed blood on the cross, he brought man and God together. That's called reconciliation. That's what Jesus did for every one of us. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. That crowd, Pilate, the priest, they weren't controlling the situation. God was controlling the situation. No cross, no salvation. No sacrifice, we remain in our sins. It was the plan of God from the beginning of the world. He knew from the beginning to the end and everything that was going to happen in between. He's the omniscient God, all-knowing. He's the omnipotent God, all-powerful. And he's everywhere at the same time. Go figure that one out. What man is this? That while he hung on the cross, after the scourging, well, they almost killed him there, but they weren't going to kill him at the scourging, were they? Because my Bible doesn't say that he got slain in a scourging. It says he got hung on a tree outside the gate. And that's what they did. They took him and he bore that cross up to Calvary's mountain.
Golgotha's hill, a place that looked like a skull because of all of those that had died on the cross. And after they had scourged him and ripped his body open, he was one bloody mess. He was hard to even recognize in his face that he was a man. He had been slapped, he had been hit with fists, and he had been poked, and all that crown of thorns in his eyes, he was swelled, he was bleeding, he was bloody, he was a mess on the cross. They picked that cross up once they nailed him, and they dropped it in the socket in that hole in the ground, and it hit with a thud in the ground. The Bible says in Psalm 22, hundreds of years, if not thousands, before Jesus was even born, all my bones were out of joint. That's how hard the thud was. As he hung in the agony and the pain, and as the blood streamed and pooled below the cross, he still managed to take care of a few things. John, behold your mother. And woman, behold your son. I'm going away, but he'll take care of you now. Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. They are ignorant to it. Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus looks over to that thief on the cross. You are exactly what I'm here for. Today, you'll be with me in paradise. What kind of man is this? Who is this man Jesus to you? Is he just a man? Are these just stories? Are they myths? Are they fairy tales?
You know, there's more historical facts that Jesus was real than there are that George Washington was the first president of the United States. Do you believe that George Washington's first president of the United States? I do, but I wasn't there. I never saw him. The Bible is true, folks, and it's time that we got a hold of the truth and hung on to it. What kind of man dies for sinners? Would you let your only son die for no good people? Would you let your son die for a murderer? Would you let your only son die for someone who didn't deserve it? They should die for themselves. Listen, we should all die and go to hell in our sins. God did. What kind of man is this? Who relieves our doubts and our fears? Are you fearful? We live in a fearful time in this world. We don't know what waits around the next corner, and I'm telling you, it's dangerous. Well, you better be praying and trusting God every single day. You walk out of your house, and you don't even have to walk out of your house. Anything can happen anywhere at any time, and it's getting worse by the moment. But yet, this man come into your life and calm your doubts and your fears. Have you experienced that? Do you feel that today? What kind of man raises up the fallen? How many times have you said, well, that's the last time that person's going to do that to me. I'm all done with them. I'm done wiping them off, scratching them off. I'm all done with it. Aren't you glad that God doesn't work like that?
That every time he tries to guide me down the right way and I go the wrong way, he doesn't go, that's it. I'm all done with Joe. I've had enough of that. I've done told him 100 times to do this and that, and he just ain't going to do it. Aren't you glad God doesn't do that to us? Yeah. Do you really know who Jesus is today? If you're lost and you don't know him as your personal Savior, and you've never asked him to come into your heart and be your Lord and believe that he died on the cross and rose from the dead and is coming again, if you've never experienced that, then no, you don't know who he is. But by believing that and accepting that by faith in God to give you the gift of faith to believe it all, you can know him today. Christian, where are we today? Have we lost sight of who Jesus is? Have we lost sight of how wonderful and powerful and almighty that he is? Have we looked at the world and we've started beginning to believe that the world is greater? We've started believing that the enemy is greater than God? Or are we at a point where we need to turn back and say, no, greater is he that's in me than he that's in this world. There's no one greater than God. The devil will not overtake God ever. Have you lost sight of who he really is? And maybe today, you remember, he can step to the bow of your messed up life and say, peace, be still. He can raise you up out of the horrible pit and out of the miry clay. If you don't know what miry clay is, you should go to Kentucky or Tennessee. It's a red, miry clay, or West Virginia, too. That stuff sticks on your feet like bubble gum. As you walk, you get taller because it just keeps gathering up. Slicker than snot, I'll just say it. Slicker than snot. He'll pick you up out of the miry clay and out of the horrible pit, and he'll set you on a solid rock. How are you building your life? On sand? When you build your life on sand, you know what happens? The winds blow. And the rains come. And great are the forces of nature. And that house that's on the sand will shift and fall and collapse. But if you have your house on the rock, the solid rock, the Lord Jesus Christ, guess what? You don't face any of that. No, the winds still come. The rains still come, and they beat heavy on it, but because you're on the solid rock that cannot fall, you will stand through it all. Which one do you want to be on this morning? Let's stand together. I'm so glad that in 1975, senior in high school, I'm glad that I put out of my mind what somebody might think of me or say about me or think of me in any way. I just kind of got alone in that pew that morning, just me and God. As God spoke to my heart, it was so overwhelming to think about his great love for me, a sinner man. No good. It was more than I could take. And I made my way down the outside aisle to come and knelt in an old-fashioned altar and said, Jesus, I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. And I met Jesus on that day, I may not have always over these years been all that he wants me to be, but I'll tell you this, I've never forgotten who he is and what he can do in my life. He's helped me get up many times and keep moving forward. You know, I remember years ago when Carol used to golf with me, and she'd hit the ball from here to that wall, and she'd get so disgusted, but I kept telling her, as long as you're moving forward toward the hole, it's all good, right? I might hit it 300 yards, but it might be 200 yards that way. That ain't doing me no good, right? We keep moving forward. So there's lots of times in my life he's helped me get up and keep moving forward. Sometimes I felt like the progress was small, and I wasn't taking those giant steps I wished I was taking in my Christian life, but I was still moving forward. Have you lost sight? Well, this is a great time to get your vision right, to get a new look at a wonderful Savior. As Linda plays this song, just bow your head and close your eyes. If you feel the need to step out from where you are and come and kneel at this altar and talk with the Lord, that's what it's here for. That's what we're here for. That's what we want you to do. That's what God wants you to do. Do you feel the Spirit of God pulling on you this morning? Please don't shove that aside. Please just come. Let him do something in your life today. As we tarry for a moment, would you come?
Those of you watching my Facebook at home, who do you see Jesus to be in your life today? I hope you might kneel where you are and say, Lord, be all in all to me today. Meet my every needs and cares. If you do that, would you let us know, please? We'd like to pray for you, your family, your situation. I hope that you will. Lord willing, we'll see you on Wednesday night. Father, we are so